We are ready to get started with our second presentation, Sweet Pie Organics. Liliana, Cantrell has presented in our RTP location. She is a Where Are They Now presenter, in that she presented at 1MC probably 2.5 years ago when she was first getting started. She's made tremendous traction since then. So please welcome Liliana to hear about her update.
I'm Liliana Cantrell, and I'd like to apologize for the traffic jam that I put into the morning. So I'm the founder and CEO of Sweetie Pie Organics. Sweetie Pie Organics is a line of organic functional foods for moms to be and new moms. I myself am coming from the baby food industry, infant formula category, and I have worked with brands such as Nestle and Hip. And I have started Sweetie Pie because I knew where the market pain was. In my formula category, $6.2 billion category is bleeding out market share to breastfeeding. New generation chooses to breastfeed. There is a massive pro-breastfeeding movement because of the associated benefits. The pediatric community recommends exclusive breastfeeding up to 6 months. Last year, 80% of moms chose to breastfeed, and 70% of them had a problem with their milk supply. And if a mom doesn't have enough milk, her baby is not getting enough nutrition. The baby is hungry and crying. And that creates a very high pressure situation for a mom to find a lactation product that would help her boost her milk supply and provide nutrients and food for her baby. The lactation market is fragmented, represented by smaller legacy products. And there wasn't a magic pill in the market, so we have created the most complete solution in the market. We have combined supplement-grade active ingredients, galactatgogues, with lactogenic foods, which are foods that help to boost milk supply, and have created our lactation smoothies. Just to give you an idea about the competitive landscape, lactation, those are all legacy products, smaller brands, and they provide just one benefit. Our products are providing all the benefits combined. So instead of buying 7 or 8 different products, a mom could buy one lactation, Sweetie Pie lactation product a day, and she would get all the benefits in one. That saves a lot of time and money. So we have started in 2016 in Whole Foods Market. We were very lucky because we got a national placement in 400 stores. That's not very common, but this happens with brands like ours that solve a real problem. And our company has evolved since then. We have expanded our distribution and our product line. So last year, we have entered the grocery segment, which is a wonderful segment for us. Our velocities in grocery stores are up to 12 units per store per week, and they are high-velocity stores. So you can find our products in any kind of theater, all of them. And also specialized channel and online. These iconic names, these big names, large companies, they give us placements and they back us up because we bring the millennial consumer to their stores. Millennial consumers, they value convenience and they don't trust big food brands anymore that much. They are looking for smaller brands like ours. Our products are supported by and endorsed by medical professionals, and 400 real moms have tried our product, liked it, and recommended it to their friends and family. Our marketing strategy is also built with the millennial consumer in mind. So, we are building a profitable company, and our rule of thumb is that our margins for all our products are at least 50%. we have to order 20% of all our customers who try our product, they convert into heavy users, which means that they drink or consume one sleep bar lactation product a day for several months. And based on this data, we believe that our obtainable serviceable market size is $250 million. So in other words, if we put a lactation smoothie in hands of every mom in the United States, and millennial is the largest demographic sector, in hands of every mom that breastfeeds and needs support for milk supply, 20% of these people will convert into heavy users. They will generate $250 million in revenue. So we are going to scale. We believe that we will be at $100 million point by 2018. And we are going to scale through three growth market strategies, Strategy number one, develop business with existing accounts. Add new business, develop business. So as a matter of fact, we already have launched our morning sickness drugs that help us connect these moms even before they give birth. Strategy number two, add additional doors. This year, we have entered Walmart, which is the largest company in the world, 400 stores. And in April, we went live with all our items on target.com. We had a meeting with Target's buyer last week, and she gave us wonderful feedback. They're very happy with our velocities online. And they're talking about going into stores. And strategy number three, bring innovation to the market. We are building a go-to solution for a young family. From the moment of conception, when they have problems with fertility, up to the time when they are in the late postpartum stage. So, we built this wonderful foundation. It's a self-funded company. So we built this wonderful foundation for growth. And now we are looking for working capital to scale up. So we are raising $400,000 in formal convertible note, and we believe that it will take us in 18 months to $1.2 million in revenue. I would like to thank you very much for taking time to listen to speak my story, and if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer.
That there are any particular segment of people that are more inclined to use your product, as example, Caucasian or Latinos, a more diplomatic way to say it. I mean, other than different groups of people, have you noticed that?
That's a great question. Thank you so much. Yes, we do have demographic data, and we really closely monitor all our customers. We want to know everything about her, you know, where she shops, her age, income, location, and, what demographic group she belongs to. So what we have learned that the income, actually, we believe, a misconception that, people who only can afford, high-end products and bio products. What we have learned that young families, even with a lower income, they still fall into our bracket because the market research shows that moms are willing to spend more on their baby products than on their household general products. Sure. So they really spend more.
Okay, so the reason that I asked that is we're in sort of the browning of America. The Latino marketplace is really growing much faster than almost any other demographic. And have you reached out to compare or compare foods, or do you have a connection there with them?
We do have a fair share of Latino segment in our customer segment, and they pretty much the sales data the shows that they show on the same channels, you know, it's like on channel approach. They show up at Walmart and brick and mortar, and they also go to Amazon.com, which well is convenient, as well as with the black community and, you know, the Caucasian.
So you're in Harris Teeter, right?
Yes.
You're in Whole Foods. Mm-hmm. Are you in Campari Foods?
No.
Okay, well, see me afterwards. I know the chairman, and I'll introduce you.
I have a question for you. You mentioned that millennial moms don't trust big brands, mm-hmm. and that they're a core element of your growth strategy. And then you showed a chart of a bunch of sort of like big brands, Amazon and Walmart and those kind of things. So do you have a plan to manage the risk that as you grow as a brand, that you could actually undermine your position of trust as you become a big brand?
Yeah, that's a great point. Thank you so much. And I need to clarify, when I'm talking about big food brands that millennial distrust, that's pretty much Kraft, this type of, I wasn't referring to retailers. And the strategy that these big food brands now adopt to actually get back to the millennial consumer, they buy brands like ours. And they preserve the identity of brands like ours. So they don't change, they don't select their brand name on the top of the product. They keep the identity. And that way, they still keep connected to the millennial consumer. And at the same time, you know, trying to get back the market share that is bleeding cow. They lose like 7 to 8% of market share annually. And that is the identity of the big brands. Yes, please. Yes,
sir.
I'm sorry. I
was
asking.
Yes.
Jim,
that's right. Oh, okay. I was just wondering. So, are you on plan based on where you thought you'd be 2.5 years ago? I had a plan. You know, where are you with respect to your marketplace traction?
We are pretty much, you know, on plan. There are some more ways to expand because Walmart. It's a very large account, and they have a lot of power. So Walmart, we kind of had to a little bit put a stop on growth in Walmart to control, have controlled growth, I would call it that, because the concern was that we won't be having enough working capital to support the sales. But beyond plan, we had a little bit of a setback last year with Toys R Us, but luckily, unlike other companies, we didn't lose that much money. So, and that gave us credibility. So we did a good job. I'm sorry, I'm allowing to ask this gentleman.
I'm just curious about the retailers that you've chosen. Uh-huh. I understand Wegmans, I understand Harris Teeter, but and I get Target. I would think, you know, you would continue with Publix and the Costco and higher end retailers.
Right.
But you went to Walmart. I spent 10 years in the consumer packaged goods. I've been to Bentonville a number of times.
I have the place pretty well.
But Walmart is always going to push vendors down in price. They're going to be difficult with payment terms, and they're going to push you as hard as possible so they can maximize their margins. You have a premium brand that has a niche with millennials. They would seem to be opposite ends of the strategic spectrum. So I'm curious about why you chose Walmart.
Well, thank you so much for your question. And yes, go be uncomfortable. No, I've been there several times. Well, the whole consumer taste of the whole market is shifting into organic. What was at some point premium, it's not premium thing. Now we are going to Walmart and we are buying the very same organic items. And the consumer, the millennial consumer, there is a trend, and you probably know, they all start reading the product not from the top, but they start reading from ingredients. And that's why large players like Walmart, the biggest company in the world, they respond. So they bring brands like ours because the consumer is there and the consumer is looking. As for financial side, that's a very good point. Walmart is pushing vendors to maximize their profits. And our solution to that, we eliminated the distributor. We don't do business, deal with the distributor. So that helps us to increase the margin that we can share with Walmart. And to solve the logistical problem, actually Walmart does FOB, freight on board, which means that they pick it up and they can take care of logistics, so we don't have to deal with logistics. But Walmart gives us access to the 80% of the population.
Kind of building on that, I'm curious, maybe you can put that slide back up where you had the 80% breastfeeding and the 70%. It strikes me that, you know, a lot of your, maybe the secret to your success, and by the way, just for the record, I have no kids. I've never dealt with babies. However, one of the worst sounds I can ever hear is a baby crying. Now, I would do anything to stop that. So how can you market the fact that low milk supply, like how do you educate people to make that connection automatically? Because the average millennial mom is going to have proper college education, is going to look for this kind of stuff. The mass is not that present. It's not going to make that connection. They're just going to get the kid formula and then hold the kid or do whatever they have to do, dance around the house, whatever. This seems like a much more direct solution to a problem that everybody, because what does that lead to? You know, we give kids iPads and drugs now. Right?
Oh.
This sounds like a start. Yeah. No, seriously, this sounds like, no, I want my drugs voluntarily. I don't want to have some people sticking with it. But you know what I'm saying? It's like, I mean, this seems to me like a start of a problem that we've developed in this country because kids act naturally, like you said, the kids crying out for food. But we've responded as a society with digital media and pharmaceuticals. To me, if you start to tap into educating the public about where this all fits into the ecosystem of raising a kid, and again, I don't have any experience in this, but you know, I know enough friends who have done it. It seems to me this could be a way for you to very much broaden how this product gets picked up. And when I say picked up, meaning learned about, and then now when you're negotiating with the people at Walmart, you go, look, that's my price, that's you, take it or leave it. If you want to shop, because they're interested in selling that consumer the 19 other items they're going to pick up, right? As you indicated, you're a pull.
Right.
So if they, you know, so it just seems to me like if you focused on this, it might help if you want.
That's a very fair point, and I'm totally in agreement with you. And furthermore, speaking about mom's education, you know, we do our best to educate them using digital media, but we have the pediatric community that recommends exclusive breastfeeding up to 6 months. When the mom comes to the pediatrician and she says, my baby's crying and I don't understand why, and the pediatrician understands the problem and tells her what she needs to do to breastfeed better. In addition, we are working with lactation consultants, those people who teach moms how to increase the milk supply, and they actually, lactation consultants and hospitals, buy our products and give it for free to moms for a free start. And that's a very fair point. Thank you so much for your comments and for this topic.
It's kind of a bit of a two-parter. What, first of all, do you have any percentage of direct sales online? I'm not talking about Amazon, but through your website. And kind of part of that, do you have data on how long, I know the doctor recommends 6 months, how long a mother is actually using your product, the average customer, you know, I guess per pregnancy or if that number is 6 months, if that number is a year, have you considered transitioning direct online sales to a subscription service that, you know, you just automatically send a weekly, monthly basis the supply that they need to try to keep them using longer?
That's an excellent question and point. Thank you so much. So we do know what percentage, and we do know what the lifetime level of the customer is. To answer your first question, we do direct sales, but we do it through fulfilled by Amazon. which is a consignment business model. So Amazon fulfills our orders and sends it to our customers, and they also offer a subscribe and save model. Having your own is a great opportunity, but it requires financial streams because you have to develop your own website. And at this point, Amazon has 200 million customers. Everybody in this room, I guess, has a Prime. I'll just check. Who has a Prime? Amazon. That's an answer.
Yeah.
We know everything about these people who buy on Amazon. We know where they live. We can find them on Facebook and advertise to them. We know how often they purchase. We even know what other products are in their basket. So at this stage, Amazon is a great tool to do direct-to-consumer business and subscribe and save model. But there are some ideas that we are testing to switch to a subscribe model and get value to the customer.
All right, what nutritional challenges do breastfeeding moms have? And how does your product, its ingredients, uniquely address the challenge?
Yes. Breastfeeding moms' nutritional challenge, they have three major challenges. Challenge number one, they need to hydrate. That is what the lactation consultants and everybody says. Hydrate, drink water, which is hard. Our ready-to-drink smoothie, it's a nice, easy way to hydrate and get lactogenic foods, ingredients that actually help to boost milk supply, and the active ingredient, the lactagogue, all in one. So just have a smoothie in the morning, you know, it's delicious. I encourage everybody to try it. The hydration and the second, the lactation consultant tells her, you need to eat lactogenic foods, eat more oats. How many oats can you eat? You know, every day, three times a day. So we have created our lactation bars, which I also have this meal, and I will leave here. And they are a combination of lactogenic foods. Oats that help promote milk supply. Flaxseed is a great source of omegas, omega fatty acids. Omega fatty acids are great for baby's eye and brain development. And she consumes all that in our bars, along with the active ingredient, which is a galactagogue.
A what?
Galactagogue. It's a group of galactagogues.
Oh, galactagogues, it's like a sugar, it's honey sugar, but it's... kind of like what you would...
It's an ingredient that helps you actually boost the milk supply, breast milk support, and we use screen ingredients as a And it also helps her intake 300 additional calories, which are recommended by medical professionals. But instead of just consuming sugar cookies, that the 70% empty calorie sugar, she consumes additional calories that offer nutrients, vitamins, and you know other things that she needs to build her milk support. Sorry for the long answer.
What was the third?
Hydration, lactogenic foods, and the third was they actually, when they consume the lactagogues, previously, historically, they were doing that in the form of a pill. And moms don't like pills, period. They don't like pills or medication. So we have combined an active ingredient with lactogenic foods and hydration all in one.
That probably is the
last. Okay, yeah, sure. You said it's an active ingredient. That's a loaded term.
Well, yeah, I know. It's a regulated term.
Yeah, it's regulated.
I couldn't think of another word for it, but it's really an active ingredient.
Yeah.
A supportive ingredient.
Yeah, so they have to this point. Yeah,
to support healthy breast.
Exactly.
Better try to support
it. It's a supplement.
It's not an active ingredient.
Yeah, it's just they were an active ingredient.
Okay.
Yeah, the FDA got there.
See, there you go. You just had the free FDA-related whatever consulting advice.
That's the same thing.